Good to see each and every one of you today. Amen. Happy Mother's Day, mamas. Man, amen. Well, it's time to give this morning. And I tell you, I have learned in my life that you cannot outgive God. You just can't do it. When you pour out and you give, when you give just a little, how many of you know he just pours a whole boatload right back into us? I mean, you can give just a little trickle and it's like it opens up a funnel for him just to pour into our life. That's why he says when we give to him, he gives back to us good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. How many of you know that the God we serve supplies and meets all of our needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus? I am so humbled and thankful to be a part of such an incredible church that has a heart, I believe the heart of God, in the fact that whether it's right in our backyard or whether it's on the other side of the globe, you believe in sowing and making a difference in people's lives. And every week you give faithfully in your tithes and your offerings to make that happen. Next week, our outreach team has invited all of our small groups and all of you to be a part of an incredible event that we've got in the park that's going to be happening, where we're going right across the way, just a half a mile, maybe a quarter of a mile from here in our backyard. They were out yesterday, as they go out about every other Saturday, and just knocking on doors, meeting people, loving on people in the community, just doing what God's called us to do, and that's reach our neighbors and show our neighbor the love of Jesus. Can I get a witness? Next Saturday, I want to challenge you and invite you at 12 o'clock, from 12 to 2. Now, they're going to need help prior to 12 o'clock to set up and to cook and to do all the things that will be happening over there in the park. Wow, I did not know you played the keys until this morning. I think I'm just going to sit down and let you have it, man. You play a whole lot better than I do, Ronnie. It's good to have Ronnie and Jennifer back. They were out of town last week celebrating Mother's Day, and today Ken's out of town, and so I'm over there doing double duty today, pounding on those keys. But next Saturday, we're going to be doing some awesome things in the park. Matter of fact, we're giving away 4 bicycles and to children in our community, and just whatever it takes, throw the bait out there. We're going to share the love of Jesus. And I believe somebody's going to give their life to the Lord next week. Amen? So if you want to be a part of donating a bicycle, make sure that's above your tithe today. But if you want to do that, just put it on the offering memo there. You know, I told some folks, when I came back from Ukraine 2 weeks ago, I went to Romania and then went into Ukraine, and we drove a truck full of supplies and food and over the border, and got that truck over the border for Coleman, our missionary, who's rescued 340 orphans, spent the night in basements there as bombs were going out all around him and those babies. And not only those 340 orphans, but he's rescued 2,700 people out of cities like Mariupol, got them into safe places. And was on the phone with Coleman this last week. You know, when I came back, I showed a little video of some things that happened. I said, the need is great there. I started having several of you come to me and saying, Pastor, when are you going back? I want to go with you. I want to be the hands and feet of Jesus. So Wednesday night, I just opened it up. We had a meeting in the conference room. We've got 10 plane tickets booked right now. We were carrying a team back. I had people in that meeting that night. They said, Pastor, I don't know how I'm going to do it. But I feel that God is calling me. Can I tell you, when God calls us to be a light, can I tell you, He will always make provision and make a way. Where God guides, He provides. Can I get a witness? And so I'm believing for 3 bicycles this morning. That's nothing for God. That's only $300 for children in our community right here. But these folks, I had one call. I just got to testify for a second, because I want to show you about how God works. When we say, God, here I am, use me, I'm giving of myself to you, then God just pours right back into our life. Shane left that meeting. He said, I've never been out of the country before. I've never had a desire to go on a mission trip before, but he's the head of our outreach team. He said, Pastor, I can't get away from it. I feel like I'm supposed to go. I don't know how in the world I'm going to pay and come up with this kind of money. The next morning, he called me and said, I walked into my workplace. I was telling my boss about it. My boss said, man, I'd love to go, but my wife will not let me go to Ukraine. Glad your wife will. Close your ears, Sandra. Amen. And my boss said to me, I want to pay your entire way to go. Wesley and Aubrey, you didn't know how, because I know it's expensive. Scared me to death when I clicked pay for those airline tickets the other night, and I saw what popped up on my credit card. You and Aubrey stepped out in faith. Within 2 days, your trip is almost, the both of you, almost 100% paid, at least over halfway, half to three quarters of the way. Got another person, their way's paid already, and they've already paid half of somebody else's way. Can I tell you, that's the way it works in the kingdom. All God's looking for is somebody to say, I got faith to step out. I got faith to step out. And I said all that to say, in weeks to come, we're going to ask you. There's some people that are sowers. There's some people that are goers. This is not a missions offering this morning. I'm just telling you, when you say yes to God and when you're obedient to God, even in your giving to God, God makes a way for you. There's been times where Christy and I have put our tithe in the offering plate and we didn't know how we were going to pay our bills. We've been there. There's been times that we didn't know where our next meal was coming from. I promise you, am I telling the truth? And you say, well, that's just poor stewardship on your end. Not when you've sold everything that God tells you to sell, your house, your cars, all your possessions, and you're traveling the nation and around the world preaching the gospel when He told you to do that. And then there's times where after you've done that you don't know where your next meal's coming from. But God always, did He not always make a way? And He will make a way for you, church, I'm telling you. So today I want you to stand with me all over this house. The kids are going to come here in just a minute. They're going to do something that's going to bless your socks off. But I'm going to ask you to stand. And I want you just to take your tithe this morning. If you're watching online, you can give online, nbcogcarrollton.com. Go to the giving prompts and plug in how you would like to give there. If you brought it with you, I want to challenge you here in a moment. When I say amen, just to follow suit with me, drop it in one of these receptacles up here, and God's going to bless you. He'll bless you. He'll bless your socks off. He's done it for me. And I know he's done it for you too. You've seen him do it. Father, I pray right now in the name of Jesus for each and every person as they give today, that you're going to pour back into them good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. For some, God, this might be a stretch, just like it was for our team that said, I just don't know, I don't have it. But then after they submitted themselves to you and said, here I am, God, I give you myself, then they saw you begin to work miracles in their life. And so, Father, I pray right now that as your people humble themselves and they give faithfully today to your kingdom, that, Lord, that you are going to bless them and, Lord, show them that, Lord, that you will bring it back. I ask this in the name above all names, the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen, amen. You can come if you've got your tithe, your offering, you can bring it here. As they're coming, just one more announcement. Saturday for our senior adults, it's time for our monthly fellowship. Man, God has been moving. I've been averaging 35 seniors back there, maybe even more than that on some occasions. Just a time of fellowship and food and fun and lunch and games. They've got a special singer that's coming Saturday, and she's going to bless your socks off. If you're a senior adult and you'd like to be a part of this event, I want to challenge you to come Saturday at 12 o'clock. Amen. You may be seated. Our children have something they want to present to our mamas this morning. God bless you.
Morning, new beginnings. I want y'all to just, especially the moms, enjoy what your littles have prepared for you. Amen.
Baby told God, hey, I'm kind of scared. Don't really know if I want to go down there. From here it looks like a little blue ball, but that's a great big place, and I'm so small. Why can't I just stay here with you? Did I make you mad? Don't you want me to? And God said, oh child, of course I do. But there's somebody special that's waiting for you. So hush now, baby, don't you cry. There's someone down there waiting who's on the golden line. He's making sure you're always gonna be alright. A loving angel, tender, tough and strong. It's almost time to go and meet your mom. You'll never have a better friend or a warmer touch to tuck you in. She'll kiss your bruises, your bumps and scrapes, and anytime you hurt, her heart's gonna break. So hush now, baby. don't you cry. Cause there's someone down there waiting whose only goal in life is making sure you're always gonna be alright. A loving angel, tender, tough and strong. It's almost time to go and meet your mom. Now when she's talking to you, make sure you listen close, cause she's gonna teach you everything you'll ever need to know. Like how to mind your manners, to love and laugh and dream. She'll put you on the path that'll bring you back to me. So hush now, baby, don't you cry. Cause there's someone down there waiting whose only goal in life is making sure you're always gonna be alright. A loving angel, tender, tough and strong. Come on, child, it's time to meet your mom.
Would y'all go ahead and stand with us? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, you're so great to us, Lord. Oh, we lift our hands to you because we feel your presence. Thank you, Lord. You give life.
You are love. you bring light into a darkness. You give us hope and you restore
every heart
that's ever been broken. For great are you, Lord, 'cause it's your breath, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in my lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in my lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out. Lord, oh, your goodness, Jesus. Come on, every voice in this place. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. Come on, sing with everything you got. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. Come on, sing it again. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord, 'cause it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in my lungs. So I bring it back to you. It's your breath. I give it all to you. Come on, sing it one more time. It's your breath. Lord, you're speaking to us right now. Every enemy that has come against us, it's your breath. It's your breath. Play it again. Oh Lord, we surrender. We're tired of fighting.
sing it again.
Just give yourself away to Jesus. Just lift your hand and say, Jesus, I give you all of me. The good, the bad, and the ugly. I give it all to you right now, Jesus. I want everything you have for me. I give myself away to you today, God. Father, we thank you for your presence in this place. Amen. Can we sing that chorus just one more time? Let's get it deep within our spirit. We lay it all down right now, Father. We lay it all down. At the cross, whatever we came in today carrying, heavy burdens, God, we lay them down at your feet. I give myself away.
Wherever you may send me, wherever you may take me, wherever you may lead me, I will go, I will go, I give myself away, I'm holding nothing back,
I give myself away,
so you can you, one more time, I give myself away, every part of me,
give myself away,
so you can use me.
Hallelujah. Come on, church, let's give him some praise today. He is worthy to be praised. God, you are worthy. We praise you, God. We lift your name on high. You are a good God. You never, ever leave us or forsake us. God, we love you so much today. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Do you feel his presence in here today? He's so awesome. Amen. Turn to your neighbor and say, God has got something for you today. Amen. You may be seated for just a moment. You know, we like to keep you moving up and down. Mother's Day. Wow. I just want to start off for the next few moments. Well, first of all, I just want to say thank you for allowing me the opportunity to just share my heart with you today on this special day. And I know that it's definitely a day that we honor our ladies. Excuse me. And but men, this, you're not off the hook today. This is a word for you too. And so I'm just so excited to be able to just encourage you today in your walk with the Lord. And I want to start off just by dedicating the heart of this message to some very special people in my life, some very special women in my life. One, of course, is my beautiful mom. And she, of course, is not here today. She lives in Alabama. And hopefully she's watching right now. And if you are, Mom, I love you. Happy, happy Mother's Day. And you are the most beautiful woman in my life. I'm sorry, y'all. This is, I was telling somebody a few minutes ago, it's kind of an emotional day for me when you start talking about moms and kids and sisterhood and ladies and how much they mean. You just get a little emotional. And I'm just grateful, so grateful for my mom for a million reasons. I'm so honored to be a mom of two beautiful daughters that I adore with all my heart. And I love them so very much. And as well as my beautiful mother-in-law that's here today that surprised us this morning. And so we're so glad to have Doris and Ken here today. This is Scott's mom and dad. And we're just so happy. Yes, welcome. You have taught me so much, and I love you dearly. You are just so precious to me in my life, and you've taught me how to cook. She's a good cook, and we just he's saying amen over there. So, but it is a joy to have you here with us today, and just happy Mother's Day. And I do want to ask, and I told you we're going to be up and down. I do want to ask all of the ladies here today to go ahead and stand up. Stand up right where you are. Stand up for just a moment. We want to honor you today as mighty, mighty women of God who are devoted to your family, to your church family, to your community, and who are just lovers of God, and you walk with God, and we are so happy to have you in our lives. Just give the honor to where honor is due today to these wonderful, beautiful women today. We love you. Love you so much. Amen. You can be seated for just a second. So talking about mothers, we all know that motherhood is a piece of cake, right? It's just a piece of cake anytime, right? Motherhood is like riding a bike, except the bike is on fire. There's no seat and the wheels fell off, right? Sometimes motherhood has the ups and downs of just a little bit of craziness. You never know what's going to happen. And we know that as mothers, we all go through stages in our lives where, of course, when our babies are first born, they, you know, they crawl and they walk and they say their first words. And hopefully, I hope that my babies, that when they were little, would their first word would be mama or mama. You know how they, little babies, that's how they say it. And then they'll grow up a little bit and then they'll say mommy, you know, and then they'll grow up and kind of get that tween attitude, mom, you know. And then they get a little bit older and they start calling you bruh. Yeah, that happened to me last week. Samantha, so hopefully she's watching today. Samantha is out of town. She's in New York for work, and I do miss her with all my heart. It's the first Mother's Day we've ever been separated, so that's kind of hard, but I love you, Sam. So being a girl mom to two daughters is kind of like having a broke best friend who thinks that you're rich, right? Hand it over, mom. And being a mom makes you into this amazing superhero because you shine at doing virtually anything, what, one-handed, right? We're pros at that. You can multitask. And being a mom sometimes can make you feel isolated and like you're the only one going through what you're going through. But I just want you to know that there's something always there for you when you feel that way. You know what it is? It's laundry. Laundry will always be there for you. You never, ever fail. Laundry will always be there. Today's message is titled The Letter. The Letter. And a scripture text that we're taking today is found in Luke chapter 1, verse 30 and 38. And if you would stand one more time, I promise it's the last time, for the reading of the word. If you have your Bibles, it's Luke chapter 1. Verse 30 through 38. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end." Then Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I don't know a man?" And the angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore also the Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is now the sixth month for her who was called barren. For with God nothing shall be impossible." Somebody say nothing. Nothing shall be impossible. Then Mary said, "Behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this word that's true, that's infallible. God, we thank you for your scriptures that are the foundation that we stand on. The bread that we partake for our lives, the food that we eat, Lord God, for our soul. Thank you that your word is alive and well and living within us. And God, I pray right now that you will open our hearts to receive, open our eyes to see the truth of your word, of what you want to say to us today. Father, don't let me get in the way. Father, help me to get completely out of the way, and you have your way, God. We thank you and we praise you and dedicate this service to you, God, this message to you today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. I'm not sure if you're like me, but I love getting letters. I love getting cards. I love getting mail. Like if you walk out to the mailbox and it's like you go through the bills, there's 14 bills or whatever, or sales flyers that are bombarding your mailbox. But then you run across something that's handwritten, something that's like has your name on it, somebody that took the time to write. I'm like, I can't open it fast enough. I'm so excited because I love the written word. It's so precious to my heart. So I open it really quick. But why do we feel that way? Am I the only one that feels that way, or do y'all like to get handwritten stuff too? Yeah, yeah. And so it's our human nature to want to be thought of, to want to be loved, and to want to be the recipient of something that someone intentionally took the time and wrote just for us. Life is full of verbal letters that we write every day that are sent into the lives of the people that we love the most. Our words are formed, spoken, and given to those around us each day in letters of verbal communication. Our words matter, what we say. Our words matter, our actions matter, and the intentions of our heart, they matter. When our girls were little, oh my goodness, that little video before the service started today with the little handwritten colored little pictures that the children wrote to their moms, and I just remember it all so clearly, just the moment that they would color something for me and give it to me, and my heart would just sink. It was like, oh, this is the most beautiful masterpiece in the whole world. And sometimes you couldn't even tell what it was. And I'll say, tell me about your picture. You know, it was so sweet. But they would just draw, and this is for you, Mommy. This is for you. And is it just me, or does anybody else in here, do you keep your birthday cards or Valentine cards or anniversary cards? Yeah, we've got some people that keep those. I know I love to keep those kind of cards, and especially cards of encouragement, because we've got this little golden box at home that we keep our encouragement cards in that are very special to us. And we're having one of those days, we will just pull those things out and read them and be encouraged by that word. But why do we do that? Why did we go to the trouble of keeping all those cards and having those? Number one, because it reminds us of who we are to the person who sent the card, right? It reminds us, and it rekindles. After you read a card again, it rekindles your love for that person that took the time to write you a card. And it also restores our perception of being loved, because sometimes the enemy comes in to make you think that nobody cares, that nobody even cares that you exist or alive, but somebody does. When I was preparing to get married many years ago, this I will never forget. I was like, something's missing. I haven't gotten everything taken care of. I know there's something. I said, I know what it is. It's just not complete until I write my mom and dad a letter. And so I sat down and I began to type out some things that I wanted to share with them, and I started a tradition for my parents. So the day I got married, I walked into their bedroom and they were in there, and I said, hey, you know, Mom, Dad, this is a little something for you. And they begin to open their letters and read them, and of course just crying and of all the things. It's a letter that has all these things of your life that you just wanted to share. And so Savannah found out, our oldest daughter found out about that, and we were talking one day, and I didn't really realize that she had remembered that I did that. But on her wedding day, she too gave her dad and I a letter. And one for me, one for her dad, and then one she had written for us together. And there's times that I will take these letters, and I will, when I'm having one of those days, you never have one of those days where you just feel, you just need to feel encouraged, you just need to feel loved, and you want to feel the warmth of your family, or just want to be reminded of a special day or time. But I have this letter that I brought with me today, and this is the letter that Savannah wrote the day that she got married. And it's several pages long, and of course I'm not going to read it all, but I just wanted to read just a little excerpt. Mom, I thought I would carry on this tradition you started, the one where I write a letter to my mama on this day. Where do I possibly begin to share a lifetime of gratitude? Today is my wedding day, a day I've waited for all my life, a day that you have prepared me for since the very beginning. You are my mother, my best friend, my prayer warrior, my comforter, my advisor, and my nurturer. Ever since I came into this world, you've cared not only for my life here on earth, but also about my eternal life. You are an outstanding mom, and I cannot put into words how much you mean to me. Your love for me goes above and beyond what I could ever ask for. You've raised me in a godly way, and I only hope to be as good of a mom as you are. Your influence has been extraordinary, and I appreciate all the time that you have invested into my life. Even before I realized it, you were praying for me. Prayers for everything, from my health to school to a career to a future husband. Only in heaven will you and I know the impact of those prayers in my life. You've placed me before yourself, even when I was not very lovable. You've been a true picture of Christ, unconditional love. And of course, I mean, I could never make it reading the rest of that letter, because it just sparks so much emotion, things to hear her heart, to see what she has to say about me. Because as a mom, let's get real, we all think that we're a terrible mom, and we make so many mistakes, and we've just ruined it, or, you know, well, we just live in a state of feeling like that we're failures as a mom. And to get something like that from your child, that it just encourages you. I read those letters often, but the same holds true with our relationship with God. Every day in our lives, as the role of mamas, wives, and women of God, we need to be reminded of God's love for us. No matter how much we love Him and how much we do for Him, it's our human nature to just long to feel loved by our Savior. But by reading, meditating, and declaring the activation of the letters that God has written in His Word to us, that's where it's at. That's where it's at. When we are not mindful or we forget how powerful God's love is for us, we can drift into a very unfortunate danger zone. A very unfortunate danger zone. Let's talk about that for a minute. The danger zone leads to a broken bridge that we can attempt to walk over it and not even know it if we're not careful. It's a broken bridge that makes us forget who we are when we once knew. It's a broken bridge when we let our thoughts and emotions rule us and allow them to spiral out of control. That will lead to an unhealthy mental state and lead us to the bridge of danger. Let's get totally real. I'm going to share some statistics with you today that I was alarmed to hear, but something I knew with all my heart because I've experienced it firsthand and still do. I'm not exempt from it. Just because I'm a pastor's wife doesn't exempt me from anything. I experience things just like you do. I mean, I'll share a few things in a moment, but women are under great attack in the area of mental health. Did you get that? Women are under attack in the area of mental health. Women are at a much higher risk of being attacked through their mental health than men are. And men still experience it, yes. But statistics show that women are at a greater risk. 1 in 5 women experience a great battle with mental health. 50 million Americans are experiencing a mental disorder or illness. So think that mental illness doesn't just apply to like a professional diagnosis, you know, a hospitalization or medical treatment or that kind of thing. But I'm talking about before it gets to that point where it meets us every day in life, before the journey, before that point. Here's the definition of mental illness: a wide range of conditions that affect your mood, that affect your thinking, and that affect your behavior. Wow. The enemy of our soul is roaming around every moment seeking whom he may devour. He comes to steal our joy, our peace. He comes to steal our identity in Christ. He is a liar. He is a deceiver. Someone who wants to keep our heads and our hearts in the gutter. He wants to keep us down, looking down all the time. But God says what? Look up, for your redemption draweth nigh. Totally opposite of what the enemy does and how he attacks us. So if you think that the issue of mental health that maybe is not a real issue or something that's going on strong, it is. And I want to encourage you to think about that. Just this past week, and you guys have heard the news, I'm sure. Just this past week, we've seen mental illness firsthand that took over, where two ladies walked over that broken bridge. We have the first girl, her name is Kalia Posey, and she started off her career, I think she was on Toddlers and Tiaras, and she'd gone through, you know, pageants her whole life, and she'd been in all kinds of things. She had aspirations of becoming a pilot. She was second runner-up in the Miss Teen USA pageant, and she had to look at her Instagram, to look at her life, to look at all of her accomplishments, look at her smile. She had it all together. She had everything going for her. Until the voices of the enemy lie to you. And just this past week, she said, I can't do this anymore. And she took her own life. 16 years old due to mental illness. And we all know about Naomi Judd. Naomi Judd, she's the second one that I want to talk about today, the country music icon. She was the greatest, she had the greatest mother-daughter duo. She was a woman of faith. She did love God. There were several interviews that I had read about of her, you know, love for God on CBN and that sort of thing, but she allowed this mental attack on her mind to just continually spiral out of control. At the age of 76, decided to end her own life, labeled as mental illness. Just a couple of days before, I believe that she was to be inducted into the Country Music Hall of Fame. The pinnacle of her career, decides to take her own life. We should never let ourselves feel so isolated that dying looks better than living. If you have those thoughts and you're here today, the enemy's a liar, because Christ has come that we might have life and have it more abundantly. And you can't listen to the enemy's voice in your life. Mental health downhill spirals start out as a slow fade. You don't even know they're beginning to happen to you, because it's just a slow, sneaky fade of the enemy that comes in. In denial, we begin to wrestle and fight with the struggle of the fact that we're depleted with God's strength. We don't even realize that we are just like tired spiritually. We just can't go on anymore. We're running on empty, trying to do this and trying to do that. We're running on empty. We're running on empty. We think we can work everything out on our own and give it to God later, right? Oh, I can do this, you know? I can do this. I can deal with it. And then we realize, man, what a lie that is. We can't do anything outside of God. We can't do anything. Not letting go of things that are out of our control is sometimes an issue we have. We hold on tight to these things that we want to control, but we can't control them. As women, we try to do it all. We try to be it all. And we try to carry it all. We do. Well, if I go get groceries and I put all the groceries in the trunk, I am one of those ones. I will carry 15 bags on this arm, 15 bags on this arm, use my legs, whatever I got to do to get all the bags in at one time instead of having to make another trip out to the car. Is anybody with me on that? I see your hands. See, we can do it all, right? Wrong. You can't live life full when you're running on empty. You can't be depleted and victorious at the same time. You can't. Ladies, we all know that we're stubborn as a mule sometimes. And the men said, men are like afraid to say amen on that one. So we worry and then carry loads of burdens that we were not meant to carry, and we wear out. We go, 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 go. We suppress. Keep putting burdens on ourselves, and keeps getting heavier and heavier and heavier. Corrie Ten Boom said this, and I love this quote of her: worrying is carrying tomorrow's load with today's strength, carrying 2 days at once. It is moving into tomorrow ahead of time. Worrying does not empty tomorrow of its sorrow, but it empties today of its strength. I'll just be honest with you. I have wrestled in my heart the past few weeks for this message today. When my husband shared, said, hey, I would like for you to speak on Mother's Day, and immediately things begin to run through my mind and my heart. And this happens every year. I just have this picture of what I want to speak on, Queen Esther, you know, or you know, Ruth and Naomi, and these beautiful, you know, women of the Bible that have such a beautiful message. And it's like God just said no. Up until Friday night, I even shared with my husband, I said, I don't know what God is doing here. I expected some kind of beautiful message from the Lord to give to these women on Mother's Day and to honor our ladies. But he said, I want you to talk about mental health. And I want you to talk about the anointing. The anointing of God. I said, okay, God, you just got to put this together. But if you don't get anything from today, I want you to get this. Life gets messy. We all know that. But I believe with all my heart, this is what God is saying to us today. Disciple yourself. Give attention to your mental health. Walk in your God-given authority and let me be Christ in you. Did you hear that? That's what he's saying to us today. I can just quit right now and go home. That's what he wants to say. With all my heart, I believe that. But in overcoming emotional and spiritual strongholds, and there are many that maybe are here today that are experiencing the strongholds of this battle in your life right now, But I want to encourage you, number one, here's something that we can do, is we can find some family or friends and let them become part of our tribe of what we're going through. I think as women, we all have this mask on and says, I can't let anybody know I'm going through that. And we just keep it suppressing. We don't have anybody to talk to. And we don't allow ourselves to become vulnerable in a situation. But you know what? Jesus had his 12. He hung out with, he laughed with, he ate with, he journeyed with. They were there for Jesus. They were there for him until the very end and were with him on the road to the cross. That's who we need in our life. So find you some family or friends that you can do life with and share and talk about, because you know what? 10 times out of 10, you're probably going to talk to someone that says, yeah, I've been through that too. You're not alone. One of the greatest lies of the enemy is to tell us that we're alone and that nobody will understand and that what we're going through is just an isolated case, that we're the ones that are crazy. The enemy wants to lie to us like that. But number two, we can overcome by opening the book of life. The book of life, and reading it and meditating on it. So many times we do this exact opposite. We turn on the TV. What you got for me today? And we'll just watch TV. Or we'll turn on the radio. We'll turn on whatever. We'll get a magazine. We'll see what's going on there. Till we never pick up the word and let it breathe life into us. But there are influences out there. The TV is a huge influence. You got to be careful what you see. Be careful what you hear. Because not everything is of God. We know that. Opening the Word of God is like this. I just want you to picture yourself standing on the beach in front of the ocean. Nobody there, but you can feel the wind on your face. You can hear the waves crashing. And you begin to look out over the horizon and you begin to think, wow. God is amazing to create this. And you begin to breathe it in. The ocean is my favorite place in the whole world. It's like I can just feel God. Just this creation just comes alive to me. And I love it. So for me, that's my place. I love getting with God near the water. But it's refreshment. When we open the Word, it's like rivers of living water pour out into us. It's a beautiful experience to read the Word. And sometimes, yeah, I'll read stuff I don't understand what that means. And, you know, we hit words that we don't know what it means. Oh, just pray for the Holy Spirit to show us. But you keep reading, and you keep reading, and you keep reading until you find that scripture. It's like, God, you just spoke that into my life today. Because it's full of encouragement for us, full of letters of encouragement. Why should we put on our God-given authority? Luke 10:19 says this to us. He has given us power to tread over serpents and scorpions. You know what? When I hear this scripture, I literally see in my own mind, in my own heart, the attacks of the enemy. As a Christian woman of God or a Christian man of God, we have the authority within us, the power of Christ in us, to tread over demonic attacks. When he tries to invade what God has done, tries to take away our joy, tries to take away our testimony, God has said he's given us power to tread over those evil things. Power. We have it. We have it. Luke 9:1 says, and he called the 12 together and gave them power and authority over all, not some of them, but all the demons, and to heal their diseases. When Christ left this earth, what did he do? He gave us a charge, and he said, greater things shall you do, greater things, because he's given us the power in him to do those things. Ephesians 4:27 says, do not give the devil an opportunity. We must guard our hearts. How many times a day do we give the devil an opportunity right here? Right here. Luke 10:17, the 70 returned to him saying, Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name. When we have these thoughts that begin to stir in our minds, I'm not loved. He doesn't love me anymore. I'm a failure at this. And you begin hearing those voices and attacks. What did God say in his word? He's given us power over these things, over all the demons in hell. He has given us the power to conquer them. Luke 10:19, because God says that walking in our authority, that nothing will injure us. If we're walking in our authority, that's something we have to do on our own. With his help, we can do it. Spiritually speaking, leads you on the path of life. Things are just going to run all over us when we're not walking in our authority. They're going to run all over us. So your sons, your daughters, your spouses, they need you to walk in your authority. Your home, your family, your friends, your workplace, they need you to walk in your authority, because the world desperately needs you to impact those around you for Jesus and to shine his light in a dark world. In a dark world. So how can I begin walking in my God-given authority? It sounds great, but how do I really do it? Start with some oil. Some oil. Some anointing oil. As women, we have all kinds of stuff in our purse. At our ladies' brunch a few weeks ago, we had a contest, and we tried to see if the strangest things people had in their purses. What if every one of us in our purse had a bottle of anointing oil? What if women of God were armed with the anointing oil? Why the oil? Is it have some magic potion? No. Nothing special about the oil, but what it symbolizes, what it signifies, it's a tool of declaration. It's a display of our faith in Christ to move the mountains in your life. You know, sometimes Paul said, there's going to be people, you're going to have one of those days where you just need to encourage yourself. And I think there's just going to be some days you're going to just need to anoint yourself. Just take that oil and put it on your forehead and say, God, clear my mind. Let my thoughts be your thoughts. To think on these things. Whatever's just and pure and holy and right, think on these things. That's his word. Amen. And the next thing is anoint your kids. Keep that oil in your purse. When you get them out at the carpool line before they get out, hey, hold up, let me put some oil on you, because you know what? You're going to have a good day. And God is going to protect you from the influence of the enemy at your school in Jesus' name. You're covered in the blood of Jesus. Sometimes we just let them all out of the car and just let them go about their day, not covered. We got to up our game as mamas. And the next thing is anoint your home when you feel your enemy has snuck in. We got to keep our home spiritually clean. Spiritually clean. Whatever movies maybe have made their way into our homes, whatever books have made their way in our home, I believe God wants us to have a home that's pure. We don't want to give the enemy an opportunity in any way, shape, or form. So, ladies, we got to keep our house clean. So, what does the scripture say about the importance of the oil? Anointing oil in scripture is comprised of two elements, the natural and the spiritual. So we have the natural element of the oil that you can feel, that you can touch, that you can see. But then there's the spiritual side of the oil. Spiritual, with the Holy Ghost who gives us the power. Who gives us power. Exodus 30:31. And you shall say to the people of Israel, this shall be my holy anointing oil throughout your generations. Our kids need to know what the anointing oil is. They need to know it's not something, you know, that you just pull out once a year at church sometime. But it needs to be a daily part of our lives, a weekly part. It needs to be a tapestry of who we are, because it symbolizes our faith. And it shows that we are not going to allow the enemy to come in, because we are a fighting mama, a praying mama, in Jesus' name. 2 Corinthians says this in chapter 10, verse 3 through 5. It says, for though we walk in the flesh, we are not waging war in the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ. God places so much emphasis on our thoughts. We can't walk in the authority of God if we don't take our thoughts captive. Because sometimes if we don't do that, you know what happens? We begin to cuddle with those thoughts. We begin to kind of let them settle in like a comfy couch. We embrace them and nurture them. We ponder on them. We allow them to take root in our minds. thoughts come to life and begin to overtake and overflow into our homes and into the lives of others. So when these attacks start happening, and you know the ones I'm talking about, nothing but arguing going on in your house. It's like, what has happened here? Everything just going off. Maybe financial strife, disappointments all around, whatever it is. You know what I'm talking about. You're like, God, what on earth is happening? The things we let our guards down with and come in our homes by unholy things, we've got to be vigilant and we've got to be holy. Here's what happens spiritually that many let spiral out of control to the point that they are at a place of mental illness. And when I was praying about this, I was just getting with the Lord, and I just had a vision flash before my eyes, and it's like I could see a woman just sitting in a chair, and I could see this black cloth that was being waved above her head of thoughts, representing her thoughts and the attempts of the enemy to detour her, to distract her, and derail her from the things of God. And one thought led to another, one blanket just wrapped around her head of depression. You know, I'm going through this depression. You know what? I believe that if we're all honest, we probably all face depression at some point in time. You know, I hope not, but I know I have to fight it. I have to fight it. I mean, it's real. The enemy comes in and tries to just steal your joy. But I see these things of anxiety, and I saw another sheet just kind of wrapping around the woman's head, black. And then fear comes in, or insignificance, or comparison to other women, to other moms, maybe even self-hate. You begin to hate yourself, and you become your worst enemy, just wrapped all around until we're blinded and we can't even see straight. That's what I saw. And I believe that's what's happening to so many women. But here's what happens. Continual meditations on these unhealthy thoughts or emotions lead to the path of mental illness because they grow into a fantasy reality in our own mind. We allow unhealthy thoughts to take root. These layers and layers and layers and layers that we've allowed the enemy to just wrap around. Until we say, God, what's happening? I can't see you anymore. Why am I going through this? You've left me. He didn't leave you. He never forsakes us. He's not the one that put that on our minds. We allowed it to happen. And you can fight against it. You can fight against it. Now, in closing, as they come to the music, I just want to encourage you with a few thoughts here of the life of Mary, the mother of Jesus. She was an ordinary woman who had fears and hopes and aspirations and dreams just like we do. She went through so much as a mom, so many things that we went through as mothers. Then one day an angel came to her in the part of the scripture in Luke 1:30. It says, do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Just as God gave her favor, he has given every one of you his favor. You walk in his favor. Daughters, you have favor with God. You are the apple of his eye. She had been chosen out of all the women in the world to bear God's son, and she was to name him Jesus. But I declare this in your life today. Women, you have something on the inside of you, and it's promise. It is purpose, and it is passion for the things of God. He wants to birth those things in you to make a difference in your own life, in your family, and in your church, and ultimately for the kingdom. You know, there's no telling what we could birth spiritually if we would just surrender. And say, God, you know, I'm going to have the courage like Mary did to say, let your will be done, Father. Let your will be done. What would happen if we had that attitude and that heart to God? We would have women birthing purpose everywhere, changing the course of destiny in many lives. And I want to encourage you today, have courage as Mary did. I want you to go ahead and expect the victory for your battles. God wants you to be happy, healthy, and whole. Happy, healthy, and whole. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. The peace of God that passes all understanding will guard our minds and hearts. So many times and days we go through peaceless because we're so busy. We don't make time for God. We don't read His Word. But we need those daily reminders because His book, His Word is full of letters of love to each of us. If we'll just take the time to open it, to read it, see what He has for us today. Would you stand? Mary knew who she was as a mother, and Mary knew who she was as a wife, and Mary knew who she was as a daughter of the King. She knew who she was. I want to encourage you to always be mindful every day and fill up your tank somehow, some way. Don't run on empty. Use your oil. Make time to read God's Word. Because what does it do? It reminds us who we are in Christ. It rekindles our love for Him. And it restores our relationship. He's right there to pick us up when we fall. What any good daddy would do, a good mama would do. With your heads bowed and eyes closed, being mindful of the two losses this past week to mental illness, we realize that they battled with a misconception and dealt with a battle of lies that the enemy was wrapping around their minds. They allowed a deep, dark state of mental illness to just creep in. And I'm sure it was a slow fade, a gradual fade through the years that got them to this point. But if you're here today and you feel those attacks and those darkness, the darkness of these sheets or these blankets or whatever it is just wrapping around you, blinding you from the things of God, I want you to be honest with yourself today, honest with God. And you say, Pastor Christy, I'm battling my thought life, and I need God to intervene. If that's you today with nobody looking around, just lift up your hand to the Lord and say, God, I need your strength for my thought life. I need your strength. Amen. Amen. I need your strength. I can't make it on my own, but I want my thoughts to be good and holy and right. And God, I need your strength in my thoughts. Maybe you're a mama who's let her guard down in that time with God. Maybe your house is a wreck spiritually. Maybe you need to go home and clean house and pray. Maybe you need to have this oil. Maybe you don't have any oil. I've prepared some oil for every woman in this place to take home, put it in your purse so you'll have it. To declare faith in your home, in your life. To declare God's victory in your family. If that's you today, just lift up your hand and say, I'm going to be a woman who walks in the anointing. Just lift up your hand high and say, God, I surrender. I'm going to be a woman who walks in the anointing of God. Think about what I'm saying. You're saying, God, I want you to use me. I want you to help me to be an overcomer, to be victorious, and to walk in the power that you have for me. I believe every woman's hand in this place should be raised up right now. Say, God, I want it all. Forgive me for not taking authority and walking in my God-given authority, but I'm going to start doing that. I'm going to start doing that right now, God. And over the next few moments, as we worship, this is a personal thing between you and God. I'm not going to tell you what to pray. You have to come up with that on your own, with your own heart. But I pray that you will make a place right where you are, at your seat, with your family. Come to the altar. The altar is always open. This is a place where God mends the broken, where He releases the shame from our lives, where He takes the burdens and makes them light. He helps us to be overcomers if we'll just ask and say, God, I want it. I want it. I want it. If you want it today, I want to encourage you to come pray. Come find a place for just for the next few moments to get our thought life right and to seek God for the power of his anointing. And when you come, I have this anointing oil. I want you to take one and I want you to put it in your purse. And if the prayer team could come and we're going to pray with you, we're going to seek God on your behalf. Whatever your need is, if you need a healing in your body, whatever it is, just whatever your need is, we invite you to come and pray as we worship together.
Hallelujah, you come and save me. It's
so much sweeter this way. And when I thought I lost me, you knew where I left me, and you reintroduced me unto your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together, 'cause you are the defender of my heart. You are the defender of my heart. And hallelujah, you have saved me. It's so much better this way. And hallelujah, great defender, so much sweeter this way.
As they continue to pray around these altars, we want to pray for you today. I know that Mother's Day, for some, it's a painful day. Your mom's gone. Maybe she's gone on. So I know maybe for some of you today, it's a very tough day. It's not lost on us that you're dealing with emotions today, because your mom's no longer with you. We want to pray for you today. Lord, I just pray for each and every person in this house. Lord, you know the needs of your people. You see the heart of every person, God, and those that are praying even down in this altar. So many different needs represented. But God, I know on days like today, God, it can spark emotions in our own lives, Lord, because I'm sure there's some today that are experiencing waves of emotion and grief as their mom is no longer here on this earth. Father, I pray you just wrap your arms around them today. I pray you touch them. I pray you just minister to them in only a way that you can. God, I'm asking this in the name that's above all names, the name of Jesus. This morning, before you leave, I know that I'm not rushing anything by any means. I know there are moms that have things going on, family coming over, that sort of thing. The next few moments, Pastor Ed's going to come and close us out. These altars remain open. These altars are open anytime. You come down to this altar anytime. You pray anytime. You pray as long as you want to. But before you go today, Mom, ladies, I want to challenge you, pick up some of this oil. I know there's a special gift for you in the back, but we also have these vials of oil. Put it in your purse, put it in your pocketbook, however you say it here, pocketbook, purse, whatever it is. Carry it with you. Anoint that baby's room while they're sleeping. Anoint that headboard. Anoint that door header. Clean your house if you need to. Take this oil, symbolic of the Holy Spirit. Pastor Ed, would you come and I want you just to pray a blessing over all of our moms today. And they're going to continue to pray in these altars. If you did not come to this altar, but you want to receive special prayer, they're going to continue to pray. And they'll pray for you. We'll pray for you. Somebody will minister to you today. If you came in here, maybe you're dealing with that. Well, what are people going to think? If I'm dealing with depression, I've been there. I know as a pastor, I've been there. I've dealt with it. As a minister, I've dealt with it. I told you my story 10 years ago. Went through a dark, dark, dark depression. I know it's real. Maybe that's you. Christy came to me yesterday and She said, "This is not a traditional Mother's Day message." I said, "Preach it. Preach the word, preacher. It doesn't matter what people think." I said, "It's for one person that could be contemplating ending it all. You've got to be obedient." So I don't know, maybe you've already come and you've received prayer this morning. If not, these altars are open. They're open for you to come and to be ministered to. Aren't you thankful for that powerful word this morning? Amen. Praise God. Pastor Ed.
Feel this in my spirit before I pray. I feel like there are others there that haven't come. And the grace of God is not past. And where you stand, you can still receive something. And I feel like there are those that are still carrying weight, some sense of darkness. And God can lift that, and God can give you light where you stand. And I feel like that His heart is to do that. So could I ask you just to close your eyes? And especially if that's you, would you just lift your hands all over this building? Would you just receive? I'm asking you, don't pray, just receive. Not that I'm some awesome prayer, but just that we're going to pray and trust God, and I'm going to ask God to give you something, and you should be in a place to receive. You know, you can't, I've said this before, you can't drink water and talk at the same time. So if you're in receive mode, you can't be asking and receiving at the same time. When you've asked, then you just receive. So would you just lift your hands up and would you just receive? Just let me pray, God. Across this building, there are people, Lord, that are still carrying weight. God, there's a sense of darkness, oh Lord, and heaviness, Lord, that just plagues the soul. But right now, the grace of God that is an all-sufficient grace, and the presence of the Holy Spirit that is in this place, and by His Spirit we speak the name of Jesus, the name above every name. And we speak the power of Christ that is in this place, and we speak to darkness to go, and light to displace it in Jesus' name. We speak for weight to be lifted right now in the name of Jesus Christ. We speak physically, Lord God, spiritually, Lord, for lives to sense and feel the lift of things off of them in this moment in the name of Jesus. And by that authority, we speak the name of Jesus Christ, that load will lift, heaviness will go, light will come, that the peace of God. Right now, we just pray that. We pray, Lord, peace. God, let it feel, Lord God, like a stream just flowing from the inside, oh Lord God, that's cleansing, refreshing, oh Lord. God, just this sense of grace and peace just touching, oh Lord God, and moving everything else apart and aside. We just bless the peace of God just to minister right now while people are quiet before You, hands lifted, hearts open, Lord. Peace to come. I bless peace in Jesus' name. I bless the power of that to bring refreshing. I bless the power of that to bring ease. I bless the power of that, oh Lord God, to bring, Lord, Your grace in a powerful way that they walk out of this place, Lord, with a sense of peace, oh Lord, they didn't come in with. We bless Your peace and Your presence in Jesus' name. God, the grace of God, Your loving kindness, Lord, let them feel the love of God and the joy of the Lord and the peace of the Lord. From the inside out, we bless that. And we speak that in the authority of Jesus Christ. We bless that. We thank You, Lord. Would you just praise Him now? Lord, we thank You, God, for grace. Thank You for peace, Lord. Thank You for joy, Lord. Thank You for hope, Lord. Thank You for the witness of Your love. God, and let there be numbers of lives that just feel that, Lord God, from the inside out right now. Love, joy, peace, oh Lord God. Lift, oh Lord. Grace, Lord. I bless that in Jesus' name. I bless the power of that in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Amen. God bless. If you still want prayer, there's still opportunity. God bless.